Good morning. Good morning to everyone. Good morning, Miss June, Sararitha, Brandy, Roberta. Good morning, Danielle. Good morning, Corey. Good morning. Good morning to everyone. Miss Woodley, good morning. I hope everyone is feeling okay. I'm always excited to give you a word. Good morning, David. What's up, Corey? Hey, Miss Cunny. Hey, I'm excited, y'all. We should be going back into our church soon. We are working on some things. I have a meeting with our leadership today, so with some of the leadership. And we're going to move forward from there and see what direction we'll be taking. But we are strategizing and planning to go back in real soon. And we'll keep you all updated. Good morning, Patsy. Good morning, Garrett Howard, Tamika, and everyone who's logged into the live this morning. I'm going to go ahead and try to hop in here and get us a word out. So we can move on with our day. Good morning, Miss Ashley. I'm going to go ahead and start out with a word of prayer. But once again, I'm always excited to have you all on here. God is always speaking. He never stops speaking. We just have to make sure that we are tuned in to what God is saying and who he's saying it through. I don't know about you, but I just need a refreshing word. I actually need revival. We need a revival in our church, and we need a revival in our hearts. And I believe that God is getting ready to do that. There are so many hurting people, so many people going through so much right now. And I think a lot of us were under the impression that when we came out of 2020, that 2021 was just going to present us with so many, I guess we pretty much thought that our problems would fade away, but we've come to realize that our problems still remained, you know, and removing and ridding problems is a process, you know, so things don't just go away. You have to actively work toward making things better. And I think we've also come to realize that the people that we thought could make things better for us, we put ourselves in a situation to be hurt when we especially rely on people to do it. God wants us to look to him for strength. He wants us to look to him in times of trouble because he actually has the antidote and the remedy to get us what we need. And so today I want to talk about the power of God's affirmation or God's affirming word. I don't think people realize how powerful God's word is and how his word can actually, like, literally change your life, change the way you think, change how you move. God's word will open doors for you that nobody ever thought would open. I mean, his word will even surprise you by what it can do for your life. And so, but it's very important that you begin to speak God's affirming word over your own life. Like, you have the power of life and death in your tongue, you know, and the words that you speak has the ability to create the type of life that you want or don't want. And so I'm going to start out with a word of prayer, and I'm going to jump into the word of God. Father, we thank you for, first of all, waking us up this morning. You woke us up and clothed us in our right minds, and we give you honor for that. I know that someone is on this live today, and they need a refreshing word. They need revival in their own hearts, in their minds. They need renewal. And God, we know that every day your mercies are new and fresh. We thank you, God, for all that you've done and all that you're going to do. I pray right now in the mighty name of your son that you would just be a hedge of protection around your people, Lord. I pray that you would just place us on the right path and that you begin to break those chains and reverse those generational curses and place us in a position that we might win. God, we give you the glory for leading and guiding us. We thank you, Lord, for looking beyond our faults and giving us everything that we need. We thank you, Lord, for knowing everything about us and still choosing to love us. And so, God, we worship you today in spirit and in truth. And we pray that your word just brings life to somebody this morning, God. I pray that you would just renew something, that you would reach deep down into somebody's heart, God, and that you would jumpstart them, that you would resuscitate them, God, that you would do whatever it takes to push them to the next level. I pray for that single mother with kids, that single father with kids. I pray, God, for that that marriage that's on the verge of breaking up, God, that single person who hates being single, God. I just pray right now, God, that you would just help us to look to you, God, and that we would allow you to navigate us through this life. So I pray that you would speak through me. Give me the words of comfort, the words of healing, the words of deliverance that your people need. And we'll be careful to give you all the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So if you have your Bible with you, I want you to turn with me to Matthew chapter 4, verse 4. And we'll use this verse to take off into our message today. Matthew chapter 4. This is when Jesus was in the wilderness and he was being tempted by the enemy after a fast. He had been fasting for 40 days and for 40 nights. And during the first temptation, Jesus, he responded to the enemy's attack by saying, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Let me read that again. He says, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And so during this first temptation, Jesus, he makes a statement to the enemy that I believe is a blessing to us to understand that that you can eat all the food that you want to, but that's not your real lifeline. Your real lifeline is when you eat the word of God. And so he's telling us through his word that man cannot live simply by having great meals or eating steaks or whatever. He says, but we live by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And so if we live by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God, then it stands to reason that we need to be in tune with what God is saying. And so he's telling us in essence that when you begin to speak God's word, when you begin to receive God's word as affirmation for your life, that's what gives you life. And so today I want to talk about the power of God's affirmation or God's affirming word. And so let me first of all define for you what affirmations are, because a lot of people speak affirmations. They'll wake up and they'll say, I'm great. I'm successful. You know, I'm healed. You know, they will begin to declare these affirmations over their life. And I'll get into that here in just a moment. But first of all, let me just define for you what affirmations are. Affirmations are statements, powerful words put together that are meant to affect your behavior and the course of your life in a powerful and positive way. And so when you begin to speak these affirmations over your life, and when you begin to speak God's word over your life, there are two things that are supposed to be changed in your life. One, your behavior should change. When you begin to speak God's word will change how you move. God's word will change how you live. God's word has the ability to go back and to overhaul your whole life. And secondly, God's word will change the course of your life. You could be going down the wrong path in life, But when you begin to declare God's word, it will help put you on the right path. And I don't know about you, but every now and then we need a spiritual checkup. Sometimes we get out of pocket. Sometimes we get sideways. We go left. The Bible says that we all have sinned and we all have come short of the glory of God. So yes, sometimes we do get beside ourselves, and sometimes the enemy will begin to take advantage of us, and he will put us in positions of temptation. And frankly, and just being honest, we don't always pass our test. And when we are tempted, you know, and that's what Jesus was dealing with in Matthew chapter 4. And he was showing us the only way that you're going to overcome temptation is that you have to begin to speak God's word. That's what Jesus was speaking to the enemy. When the enemy hit him with a right, Jesus hit him with a left, which was God's word. You have to be able to declare God's word over your life if you're going to have power. One thing about Satan is that Satan don't care if you're just speaking your own words. He don't care if you're just walking in your own power and in your own strength. But when you are walking in the power and the strength of God, the enemy will fear you. He will understand that you didn't come to play. You came and you meant business. Because if you continue to read Matthew chapter 4, what you will see is that Jesus kept on speaking God's word. And at some point, the enemy actually fled and left Jesus. And then the Bible says that the angels had to come and minister to Jesus after his temptation. And so if Jesus himself had to speak the word of God to make it through his wilderness experience, then who are we not to speak the word of God to survive our attacks? Because I'm going to tell you that the enemy is busy. The Bible says that Satan comes to kill, steal, and destroy. And he has never stopped killing, he has never stopped stealing, and he has never stopped destroying. But the Bible tells us that we are overcomers, or that we overcome by the power of his word, or the blood of the Lamb. You know, so you have to know God's word. You don't have to be a scripture quoter. You don't have to know every verse, and you don't even always have to get it right. You have to actually just know what the Bible is saying, and you have to be able to present that and to state it and to speak God's word to the enemy or to your situation, so that you can experience change, so you can experience the power of God being released over your situation. And so once again, the goal of repeating affirmations is to change your way of thinking and to create a better life. And I don't know anybody who don't want a better life. I need somebody to type that in. I want a better life. Because if you're not striving to do better, if you're not striving to put yourself in a better situation for your kids, if you're not working towards better goals and striving for elevation, then you don't want a better life. You know, but if you want a better life, it stands to reason that you have to begin to speak God's word over your life. It doesn't matter what type of situation you're in this morning. God's word can get you out of it. And I'm not just talking about just speaking it. It's one thing to speak God's word, but it's a whole nother thing when you're speaking the words that you believe yourself. When you believe that that man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. When you believe that God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ask or think. When you believe that God is able to take you to places that you wouldn't have been able to get into yourself. When you believe that there's power in God's word. When you start believing what God's word is saying. When you start believing that you are the head and not the tail. When you believe that you are above and not beneath. When you start believing these words that you are speaking, then it makes a bigger difference in your life. You know, so you can't just be speaking God's word if you don't believe God's word. You have to believe God's word. If you go back and you look at most of the miracles that Jesus worked, like for instance, when he healed the woman with the issue of blood, she came to him and he told her that your faith has made you well. You know, when he healed the man with the withered hand, your faith has made you well. You know, when he healed anybody in the Bible, it had a whole lot to do with their faith. You know, so when you speak God's word, you have to have the faith to believe that God's word is going to do for you what it did for others. Okay. And so Once again, the goal of repeating affirmations is to change your way of thinking and create a better life. Now, listen to me. Some people need to begin to speak God's word as affirmations over their life because of what they've always been told by others. You know, some people are walking, they're walking and living in the words that others have always spoken over their life. And it's time for people to start breaking those curses. You know, when people have always told you that you're not going to be anything, when they told you you're not going to amount to nothing, when people are always dragging you because of bad decisions that you made, when folk are holding your past over your head and it seemed like the ceiling is there, you keep on hitting the ceiling. The only thing that's going to get you out of that cycle of defeat is that you're going to have to start speaking God's word over your life. Just as you remember the things that people have said about you and that people have declared over your life, you have to start remembering what God says about you. And what God says about you is what really matters. You know, because you always live in defeat unless you learn how God views you and how God sees you. Okay, and God always sees you different than people. You know, there are people who are on this live right now who have made mistakes and have done things that people won't let you outlive. You know, and I was talking to a brother the other day, and I was telling him that you can tell what type of level people are on when they keep bringing up your past. Because there was a point in time in your life where you were probably down. You have fallen, you were leveled out. And when people go back and revisit the place that you've fallen, it just goes to show that they are on a lower level than you because you're no longer there. Just because they're stuck where you used to be does not mean that, listen, let them be stuck and you keep on elevating. And the only way that you can keep on elevating is that you have to know what God says about you. People will put you in a place to where you will never be able to get past your own stuff. You know, but if God forgives you, you have to get to a point in your life to where you forgive yourself. I need somebody to type this in. I forgive me. I forgive me. I forgive me. I forgive myself. I'm no longer am I going to let people hang my past over my head. No longer am I going to let people steal my joy. No longer am I going to allow how others view me to stop me from bettering myself. Once again, I have already declared over my own life that I want a better life. Not only do I want a better life, I will have a better life. Why? Because I'm going to learn how God views me. I'm going to tap into the power that God has made available for me, and I'm going to walk in that power. Nobody is going to stop me. Nobody is going to block me. And anybody that gets in my way, they don't really have a problem with me. They got a problem with God. And I'm going to just move out the way. I'm going to get out of my own way. And I'm going to allow God to lead me to green pastures. I forgive myself. I forgive myself for not taking advantage of that job opportunity that God gave me. I forgive myself, you know, for not making responsible decisions and putting my kids in a bad situation. I forgive myself for not, you know, capitalizing on opportunity that God has placed before me. I forgive myself, you know, for getting with people that God never ordained to be in my life. I forgive myself for spending most of my life and my ministry battling with other people. I forgive myself for not even giving myself a chance to better my own life. I forgive myself for hanging out with other people and being a people pleaser and allowing myself to go by the wayside. No longer am I going to live like that. Sometimes you have to forgive yourself for allowing people to take advantage of you. I forgive myself. I did that. No longer am I going to be pointing the finger at other people. No longer am I going to be blaming anybody else. I blame myself and I take responsibility for my own actions. But listen, starting today, I forgive myself and I'm moving forward from that. The Bible says, forget those things that are behind you, and you got to press towards the mark of the high call that God has placed on your life. And I don't care what type of background you have. I don't care if you grew up knocking people out, dragging people, you know, fighting all the time, you know, just being ratchet. It doesn't even matter the type of life that you've had. The only thing that matters at this point is the life that you can have. The life that you can have. Last week, I talked about recovery. I said there are two things that God has really placed in my heart in this season. One is resurrection, and secondly is recovery. God is resurrecting people. God is resuscitating people. God is allowing people to recover. And listen, when you recover, it's going to be a testimony to the people that know you, that know what you used to be about, that knew what you was on, that knew you had a slick tongue, that knew all that stuff. They knew all your history. But when they see what God is getting ready to do for you in this season, it's going to cause them to want to draw closer to him, because they'll understand that if God did that for you, he'll do the same thing for me. Yes, sir. We are in a season of recovery. So let me move forward. There are many different types or kinds of affirmations that people use. But as believers, it is our goal not to just rely on self, but to put our trust in the power of God's word. Every time we start relying on us to do it, we always find ourselves digging a deeper ditch. Anybody who is trying to live their life apart from the guidance of God, apart from the power of God, apart from the voice of God, I guarantee you, you can agree with me right now, that's why your life is the way it is now. You have to get to a place to where you'll start listening to the right voices. Come on, somebody. Because the Bible says, blessed is the person who does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly. You need to stop letting people give you advice that they wouldn't even take from themselves. You know, it's very important who you allow to speak into your life. Okay? So, the word of God will keep you when nothing else will. This is why it's important for you to you need to open this up right here and get to it and start reading it and digesting it and living it and believing it, because this word will keep you when nothing else will. When your friends, when their words will not comfort you, when the encouragement of other people falls by the wayside, you know, you can always look to God's word and it will give you the comfort that you need in that moment. Okay. So when Jeremiah was prophesying to the dry bones in the valley of dry bones, those bones, they started coming back to life. So every time you speak God's word, it just does something to your spirit and to your bones. It brings healing. Why? Because you're speaking the word of God. Even if you're reading Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. You know, he guides me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. If you start speaking this word, especially when you're going through a rough experience, when you're going through a valley experience, God will remind you through speaking his word that he is your shepherd. So often we have relied on people who does not have the power to help us. We have put our trust in the wrong folks. God's word will help you every time. Any person that's depressed right now, read God's word. Any person that's lonely, read God's word. Any person that's broke and you have no money in your account, read God's word. And not only do you need to read God's word, but start trusting God to be everything that you need. Our problem is that we don't trust God enough. If you never hit a brick wall, if you never hit that point to where you couldn't move or you couldn't go, then you would never look up. So sometimes God will allow us to run into these circumstances where your sister can't help you, your brother can't help you, your mama can't help you, your BFF can't help you, your husband can't help you, your boyfriend can't help you, can't nobody help you but God. And he will allow these situations to come so that you will come to the realization that, hey, I need to look up now. You know, I can't do it. My people around me can't do it. My circle can't do it. So there's no other option but for me to look up. And the sad thing about it is that even during these moments, some people still won't look to God. I don't understand it. So many people are in predicaments that they don't even have to be in. God is waiting on you to look to him for help, to ask him for help. You have not because you ask not. So at some point, you have to start asking God. You have to start having a dialogue and conversation with him, you know, and he will navigate you out of your circumstance. And if he keeps you in it, it's because he's trying to teach you something or you have not learned your lesson yet. You know, God is not going to pull you out of something and put you in something else that you're not ready for. You know, he's a God of order and he's very strategic in how he moves. So, I'm going to give you some affirmations here in a moment. John 6:63 says this. It is the Spirit who gives life. It is the Spirit who gives life. Let me say it again. It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. I'm in the Bible. The flesh profits nothing. That means anything that I do in my own strength is not going to bring me any profit. And I don't know about you, but I want to profit in life. I want to get to a point to where I can look and see that there have been gains in my life. Okay. And so if you're going to gain, you're not going to make any strides by walking and operating in your flesh apart from God. The scripture says that the Spirit, it is the Spirit who gives life. That's the word. The Spirit gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. This is what Jesus is saying. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. Now, when a person is going through a tough time in life, there are two things affected. One, their spirit. You can always tell when a person is going through something if you are a discerner of spirits. And what you will discern in a person that's in a bad place is that their spirit is low. Their spirit is low. Their countenance is low. And that's because they're missing something. Anytime you are missing the main ingredients, it causes your spirit to go low. Because there are people who go through stuff every single day. But guess what? They allow this stuff to bounce off of them. You want to know why? Because they are walking in the power of God. That's why people look at them and be like, man, do you realize what they've been through? How in the world are they still here? How are they still clothed in their right minds? How are they still doing well in life when they have just come out of that? It's because they are, it's not that they don't, they're not affected by it, but they're not affected to the degree that it brings them down because they are constantly running back to God, being refilled. And you have to run back to God. Keep on running back. If something hits you and causes you or your spirit to be vexed, run straight to God. Don't wait. Don't try to fight the battle yourself because the battle does not belong to you. The battle belongs to the Lord. And so Jesus says that it is the Spirit who gives life, not your friends, not your circle. It is the Spirit who gives life. And the Spirit in the Bible has the capital S. That is God's spirit. When you see the capital S, that's God's spirit. The little case S, that's your spirit. And so it is God himself who gives you life. And he's told you that your flesh profits you nothing. Your flesh will get you in trouble. You know, the Bible talks about how every single day our spirit is wrestling against our flesh and our flesh is wrestling against our spirit. You know, so now before you go, let me give you these affirmations right here. I'm going to give you about five. I have so many more, but I'm going to try to just drop five on you that will help you in this moment. The first affirmation I want you to start speaking over your life is that God comforts me in all of my tribulations or troubles. God comforts me in all of my troubles. You need to know that when you're going through, that God will comfort you. You need to know that. You need to know it. Tribulations are defined as troubles, problems, or peril. Okay. And I don't know anybody in this life who don't have issues. If you're that type of person that's always talking about what somebody else is going through, it's because you have minimized your own stuff. And sometimes people are just miserable, and misery loves company, you know, but there's nobody in this life who's not going through something right now. I need everybody to type amen. I see 49 viewers over here, and I see 9 over here, and there are probably more watching. There's nobody in this life who's not going through something. I don't care what type of picture you paint to your social media friends. It does not matter. Everybody is going through something. If you're single, you're going through something. If you're married, you're going through something. If you work, you're going through something on your job. Some people dealing with health issues. Some people got folk that are thorns in their flesh. They're at war with other people. Some people are at war with themselves. It's a lot of stuff going on in people's families. You know, folk, kids are rebelling. It's just a whole lot going on. You know, so the truth of the matter is that everybody is going through something. People are still burying loved ones. Folks are still fighting COVID. You know, we got stuff going on in the government. We got all these conspiracies going on. You know, it's just a whole lot going on. And once again, everybody is going through something. I can say that, and I can say that with confidence, that everybody is going through something. And if you're not going through something, get ready. You're going to go through something. And if you're going through something, you're coming out. You know, it's a constant cycle of us going through stuff. But the scripture teaches us that God comforts us in all of our troubles. In this life, you will have trouble. Jesus said that. But it is the Lord who comforts us through them all. 2 Corinthians 1:3-4 says this. Blessed be the God and Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our afflictions. Listen to that. With the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. Now, this is what I love about this verse. The Bible says that God comforts us in all our afflictions. That means that even in your affliction, that you can still find the comfort of God. That's good news. And the reason it's good news is because God does not wait until the affliction is over to come to your rescue. God does not wait until you come through the fire to show up. If you go back and you read in the book of Daniel, you'll see that the Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, Daniel, God showed up in their situation. He showed up in the lion's den. He showed up in the fire. And that's the type of God that we serve. A lot of people think that they have to be in the best situation in order to experience God. But most of us experience God in the lion's den. Most of us experience God and really didn't get to know him until we were in the fiery furnace. You know, so when life is peaches and cream for people, they ain't trying to get to know God. A lot of folk ain't even thinking about God. It's that sick bed that gets your attention. It's that fiery furnace that gets your attention. It's that bankruptcy that gets your attention. It's that divorce that gets your attention. It's all the troubles of this world that gets our attention and make us look to the hills from which comes our help. But through it all, and many of us have had people to abandon, to leave us, to fend for ourselves, but God never left your side. He never left your side. And even the junk that you got yourself into, God never left your side. Do you hear me? Because God doesn't just show up when the enemy puts you in a complex situation. God shows up even when you put yourself in one. God shows up even when you can't even point the finger and say nobody else did it. God shows up even when you can't even say the devil made you do it. He shows up when you put yourself in a figure four. God shows up when you put yourself in a catch 22. God shows up when you willfully do what he tells you not to do, and he still brings you out, and he never throws it up in your face once he delivers you. He just go and say, go and sin no more. Now, how many people do you know that will actually help you out of a situation and not go talk about it? How many people have been hurt because you put confidence and you trusted someone to help you through a tough time, and then they went back and told everybody your business? The things that you told them in confidence, now they spreading your whole story over the city. And you wonder why people looking at you crazy. God knows what's going on with you. He delivers you. He comes and he shows. If you call him, he's going to show up. If you tell him to get to the area, he's going to tell you, I've been there. He's everywhere at the same time, and he will come to your rescue. But listen, sometimes you got to call folk. Some of y'all be holding people accountable and mad at folk that didn't show up when you never called out for help. You expect people to read your mind. You know, I've had so many people mad at me over the years because I wasn't there. How do I know to be there if you never call me for help? I'm not a mind reader. I'm not a psychic. I'm a preacher that rely on God to navigate and lead me. You know, but I cannot read your mind. If you're over in your house, cooped up in a corner, you know, depressed, and you haven't told anybody what you're going through, then you can't fault your pastor because he haven't called. Because one thing for sure is that when you're going through, the enemy is going to box you in, and he's going to go to work on your mind. And the next thing you know, you're thinking about everybody who's not there, all the people who didn't show up, and you over here by yourself, and everybody out there living the good life, and I'm over here, and it seems like nobody cares for me, nobody called me, nobody's texting me, you know, and you start thinking about all the folk that did this and did that. That's the enemy playing on your mind. He's playing on your mind, and he's going to have you by yourself because you're going to burn all your bridges because you're going through a rough time that nobody knows about. And even if they did know about it, it's not really their responsibility. God, he's telling you, and he's making it very clear that you need to look to me. Stop depending on other people to deliver you out of stuff that I already prepared your deliverance from. So God comforts me in all of my tribulation. That's your first, first affirmation. Your next one is my sufficiency is in God. My sufficiency is in God. And I'm going to define for you what sufficiency means. Sufficiency means adequate for the purpose. Adequate for the purpose. When I am sufficient, that means that I am adequate for the purpose. What purpose? The purpose that God called me to, I'm adequate for it. In essence, it means that I am enough. As a matter of fact, I'm more than enough. I need somebody to go ahead and type that in. Because some people will have you thinking that you don't have what it takes to get the job done. Woo, Lord have mercy. I felt that in my soul because I just believe that there's somebody on here who don't feel like they are sufficient enough to get the job done. You don't think that you are a sufficient mother. You don't think that you are a sufficient spouse. You don't think that you're sufficient enough to bring peace. You don't think you're sufficient enough to get the job done. And listen, your sufficiency is not in people. No longer am I going to allow how you view me and what you think about me to define my sufficiency. Because how you view me might change. And if how you view me changes, then what you think about me is going to change. How many of y'all have people that you used to rock with, that used to speak well of you, that's now dogging you out? And the reason they're dogging you out now is because how they view you have changed. And so God says, I don't want you to leave your destiny to the words of other people. He says, I need you to live by how I view you, okay? And so sufficient means that I'm adequate, and those are words that you need to speak of yourself, and you need to have your children to declare this, oh, I'm more than enough. Do you know what those words will do to somebody who has always been told that they're not enough? You're not enough for your man. You've never been enough for your mother. You've been the black sheep of your family. Your siblings always seem to have excelled. And here it is, you over here, the black sheep. You don't seem like you fit in. You go to church, you don't fit in over there. Everywhere you go to work, everybody's gathered in the corner at a cubicle talking, and you the outcast. Why? Because the enemy is trying to make you feel like you are not enough. The enemy is trying to make you feel like you are not enough. And you need to constantly declare over your life, I'm more than enough. I am more than enough. I don't care what they said about me. I don't care how they act toward me. I don't care if they kick me out of every social circle there is. I don't care if people don't like my social media posts. I don't care if I don't get that type of love. Listen, in God's eyes, I'm more than enough. Listen, I say in God's eyes, I'm more than enough. I'm not going to allow people to define my value. It doesn't matter if I don't live how you live. It doesn't matter if I don't drive what you drive. It doesn't matter that I don't have the money that you have. Those things don't define me, because the Bible says, what does it profit a person to gain the whole world and to lose their soul? What does it profit me to move into a mansion and I don't know God? What good does it profit me to drive a Bugatti that I could have a wreck in and die in it and die without God? What difference does it make? What difference does it make for me to have 2-3 chains hanging around my neck worth $10,000, but I don't know God? What difference does it make for me to have every pair of Jordans that come out, you know, but I don't know God? We have allowed things to define our value, and putting valuable things on you don't make you valuable in your soul. There are people wearing Jordans, there are people driving Lexuses, there are people driving all type of nice stuff. And ain't nothing wrong with that. But if those things define you, you're not worth much. You're not worth much. Because the moment you can't wear that, the moment you can't rock that that pocketbook, the moment you can't afford Louis Vuitton, Versace, you know, the moment you can't get that stuff, then you don't feel so cocky then. You don't feel so secure. You don't feel, and that's why people will do just about anything in those moments they can't afford it to get it. They sell their soul so they can do one or two posts on social media so they can get 200-300 likes. And some people be just doing the most. But you miserable. You miserable. Your soul damaged. Your soul need to be repaired. And that's why you're doing all this extra stuff. You're doing all this extra stuff because you're trying to find value in it. You want to be liked by people. You know, and have them people that's hitting like don't even know you and don't even want to get to know you. And then after they hit like, they don't think anything else about you. You know, so you rock your outfit and everybody see it. It's nice or whatever, you know. But so, I mean, anybody can put on a nice outfit. But that outfit should never make you. You should be able to just throw on something and still feel as valuable because you know what value your soul holds. And so once again, being sufficient means adequate for the purpose. I'm more than enough. Your value should never be determined by what you see in someone else. Your value should never stop trying to compare yourself to other people. I have always been in my own lane. I'm going to be Ron King. I'm going to do it how I do it. I'm going to rock it how I rock it. I don't define myself by what somebody else wear and what somebody else have. I'm the original Ron King. I'm going to be me. And you got to be you. Listen, but let me just give you this illustration. When preachers started wearing jeans and stopped wearing clergy collars and you know, wearing suits every Sunday, you know, I kind of start doing that stuff before a whole lot of people. And when I wasn't wearing suits and wearing robes and wearing clergy collars and wearing all that stuff, everybody thought I was crazy. They thought, like, this dude crazy, like, he young and he's in violation. You know, he preaching in jeans with holes in them. He got on Jordans and tennis shoes. He doing this and he doing that. And then years later, Ain't nobody talking about that no more. Why? They ain't talking about it because everybody doing it. You know, so you got to be who God has called you to be. And being who you are and who God has called you to be doesn't mean that everybody is going to agree with it. It doesn't mean that everybody's going to understand it. It doesn't mean that everybody's going to pat you on the back. I don't need no pat on the back for being myself. And somebody just said the word authenticity. Authenticity. Be authentic. Because when you're authentic, you're not doing it for other people. Your value is not determined by how they view you if you're authentic. If you're authentic, you're going to be the same whether they pat you on the back or not. If you're authentic, you're going to wake up. You don't have to think about who you're going to be because you're authentic. You're going to naturally be who you are. And so moving forward, once again, your value should never be determined by what you see in someone else. Okay, because some folk ain't as valuable as they think they are because their value is determined by materialistic things. You know, don't think that you ain't up to par because you don't have what other people have. Sometimes you can live such a more peaceful life when you're not working extra hard to live by somebody else's means. Some of the most happy people in this life are people who are basic and simple. The people who have issues are the folk that's trying to be like somebody else. Those are the ones headed to bankruptcy court. Those are the ones that's head over heels in bills and complaining and got to work extra overtime, you know, to try to maintain. Those are the people that's miserable because they're not authentic. They're trying to duplicate somebody else. And if God wanted a duplicate of somebody else, he would have made two of them. But he only made one of them. And so when you're authentically yourself, that means you live, you don't live above your means. You live within them. You live within your means. Okay, so 2 Corinthians 3:5, I'm not even going to be able to finish this. 2 Corinthians 3:5 says, not that we are adequate in ourselves to consider anything as coming from ourselves. That means that I understand that I'm not the one who's doing this. I understand that my blessings don't come from me. I understand that it's not because of my pedigree. I understand that it's not really just because of my degree and because of my family lineage. It's not because of that. He says, my sufficiency is not in myself. He says, but our adequacy, we're talking about believers, our adequacy is from God. What makes me adequate is my relationship, not my clothes, not my shoe collection, not my book collection, not who I'm married to. What makes me adequate is the fact that I am in a full-fledged relationship with God. Y'all didn't hear me. That's what makes me adequate. So it doesn't matter what they say about me. It doesn't matter if they're blackballing me. It doesn't even matter if they like me or not. My adequacy does not come from them. Sometimes people would love to be the reason why you think you're adequate. You know, like you don't have to connect with everybody to be adequate. You don't have to be accepted into every circle and invited to every meeting to be adequate. There are some people who are social media famous that God don't even know. There are people who are popping and doing nice things that ain't in a relationship with God. There are people who's doing well in life and have made some boss moves or whatever that ain't going to heaven. There are some people who have a good earthly life that will see God face to face and hear him say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. And so if you think that you got to be popping in the eyes of society to be relevant, then you're missing the whole point. Your adequacy does not come from being popping, from everybody knowing who you are and everybody calling your name, because it's going to be sad if everybody has called your name on earth and God calls your name to tell you to get away from him. So don't get it confused. Your adequacy and your sufficiency does not come from men. It comes from God. So once again, declare my sufficiency is neither defined or measured by other people. God says in him, I am enough and I have enough. God says in him, I am enough and I have enough. And so it is perfectly okay for me to declare that I'm all right. And the reason I can declare that is because I know who I'm connected to. One thing about my son and my family and those who know me, if you connected to me and I got it, then I'm going to help you if I can. You know what I'm saying? It's the same way with God. We know he got it. We know he has it. The Bible declares that he's already stored things up for you. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with many spiritual blessings in the heavenlies. They are already stored up for you. And all God has to do is release them into your life. But in order for God to release your blessing into your life, you got to make sure that you are properly lined up. There are so many things that God wants to do that you got to position yourself for. So I need you to declare this. I'm almost done for today. I think I've gone over a little bit. God says, in him, I am enough and I have enough. I am enough. I have enough. Okay? Because if you have enough, but you don't know that you are enough, then you're still in a complex situation. But if you can declare them both, that I am enough and I have enough, you don't have to worry about nothing. And so I'm not jockeying to be somebody's BFF. I'm not jockeying for no position. I ain't compromising who I am to fit in nobody's crowd. Let me tell you why. Because I am enough and I have enough. You know, it's people that's desperate. It's people who pressed. You know, when people are pressed, then they take desperate measures. You know, but if you are a child of God, you ain't never got to be pressed. You ain't never got to be pressed because God is going to work that thing out. You know, you just can't abandon the process. You know, so you, if you're a child of God, don't be pressed, because if you live a pressed life, then it's going to always be somebody who's out there to take advantage of you being pressed. So many people find themselves in compromising positions because everybody know you press. And if you press, then you're willing to compromise so you won't have to be pressed. But listen, if you are pressed, look to God. I'm trying to tell you, look to him. He's always there. And he ain't going to put your business on blast. He ain't going to put you on Front Street. He won't do it. Look at all the stuff that you've done that nobody knew about. Look at all the stuff that you've gotten away with as it relates to the public's eye. God saw it all, you know, and God never blasted you. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that love covers a multitude of sin. Everybody should be shouting on that. Everybody watching this live should be shouting over the simple fact that God covered some stuff that he could have exposed. He covered some stuff that he could have exposed. Y'all didn't hear me. I'm talking to everybody. God covered some stuff about you that he could have exposed. That's a reason to shout. And so, I'm going to do one more. The last thing I want you to declare over your life is that I will fear no evil. I will fear no evil. There is no way to avoid evil in this world. We will always be surrounded by evil. Okay? It doesn't matter where you go. Evil is in the church. Evil is in the home. Evil is in our families. Evil is everywhere you go. Evil is at the park. Evil is in the streets. Evil is beside you. I mean, you might be sitting next to evil. But the truth of the matter is that Psalm 23 reminds us of a shepherd who teaches us how to walk through the valley. Okay? We read Psalm 23, but we read it too fast. Next time you read it, slow down and hear when the writer says, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death." And I need you to hear this part. He said, I'm walking. Yea, though I walk through the valley. Our issue is that when we are in a valley experience, it causes fear to arise because we are not comfortable in uncomfortable situations most times. And so when we are in a valley experience, evil lurks in the valley. Evil lurks in valley places. When Jesus was in the wilderness, which was a valley, that's where the devil tempted him. Okay? And so, but here it is. David says, I walked through the valley. Okay? He didn't say I ran through the valley. He didn't say I jogged through the valley. He didn't say I sprinted through the valley. David says, yea, though I walk through my valley experience. How was he able to walk through the valley experience when evil is lurking in the valley? The reason he was able to walk through the valley is because he kept his eyes on the one who was leading him through it. He kept his eyes on the shepherd. Yes, he saw all the evil in the valley, but he never lost sight of the shepherd. Anytime you lose sight of the shepherd, then the sight of evil will prevail and cause fear to arise. But the Bible says that God has not given us the spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. So even going through the valley, David was able to have a sound mind because he was being led through the valley by the shepherd. Lord have mercy. And so if you are in a wilderness experience right now and fear has arisen, let me encourage you to put your eyes back on the shepherd. Put your eyes back on the shepherd. Stop trying to run through the valley, because there's a reason that God wants you to walk through it. There's a reason David had to walk through the valley. It's because God was teaching him and preparing him as he was going through. And so a lot of times God will use your valley experience to train you. Let me say it again. God will use the valley to train you. When armies do a lot of training and basic training, they go out to large fields because that's where the training ground is. And so fear stagnates a person and prohibits them from moving forward. But the shepherd shows us how to navigate through the valley. I believe many people stay in the valley longer than they have to because their momentum stops when they face difficulty. Don't ever stop moving. Don't ever stop momentum. Because once you stop momentum, it's hard to get it back. It's not that you can't get it back, but it takes a little time to build momentum back. And so even if you are in a wilderness experience, don't stop moving your feet. I can remember when I was in middle school, I tried out for football. I wasn't really a football person because I don't like people touching me. I don't like nobody. Don't do it. But I can remember like the coach saying, if I don't remember nothing else, I remember this. Once you make contact with your opponent, never stop chopping your feet. Never stop moving your feet. Keep driving your opponent back. And don't stop until you hit that ground. You keep on moving your feet. And I believe that God is saying that right now to us. Keep moving your feet. Even if you hit your opponent, keep moving your feet. Even if you run into an obstacle, keep moving your feet. Don't ever lose momentum, because if you lose momentum, it takes a while to build it back. And so the last thing I want to say is that I need you to declare this over your life. My sufficiency is in God. We've already said it, but we say it again. My sufficiency is in God. And so here are the points that I'm going to give to you again. God comforts me in all of my tribulations. My sufficiency is in God. I will fear no evil. I will fear no evil. And I'll leave the other ones for later, because I can go on and on about affirmations. But once again, I need to define for you that affirmations are statements, powerful words put together that are meant to affect your behavior and the course of your life in a powerful and a positive way. The goal of repeating affirmations is to change your way of thinking and to create a better life. And so I hope that we have done that today. You can just start with those three affirmations. Start speaking them over your life and start believing them, because there's power in God's word. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Let me pray with you. Father, we thank you for every person who is in this live, who visited this live. We give you honor for them, God. We thank you. The fact that they were on the live tells us, God, that you were gracious to them. You woke them up this morning. You clothed them in their right minds. And God, we come to you today asking for forgiveness. Forgive us for our disbelief, our unbelief. Forgive us, Lord, for moments and times where we did not trust you enough. Forgive us, Lord, for doubting you and doubting your word and not speaking your word over our lives, God. Forgive us for not declaring what you say about us, Lord, and taking other people's word over yours. And so, God, we come to you asking, God, that you would change the way we think, that you would allow us to declare these affirmations over our lives, God, and that they will begin to make a difference, that we will begin to see ourselves different, that our relationship with you will be enhanced. We pray right now in the mighty name of Jesus that you would help us to live, to outlive those negative things that people have spoken over our lives over the years, and that you would eventually pluck those things up by the root and replace them with positive affirmation, the word of God. We thank you, Lord, that the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, God. We honor you. We lift you up, God. We thank you for just being a mighty God. We thank you for your mercy and your grace every single day. We thank you, Lord, for allowing us to be alive today, God. You woke us up and you breathed into us the breath of life, God. You've given us another chance. As a matter of fact, you give us chance after chance to get it right. And that's because you are long-suffering, God. You are a very patient God. And we thank you for that, God. And I pray that you would help us to be as patient with others as you are with us, Lord. And I pray that we would constantly look to the hills from which comes our help, knowing that our help comes from the Lord. I pray, God, that nobody who belongs to you will be pressed. I pray that nobody who belongs to you will live in suffering, God. I pray, God, that you would deliver your people from evil, God, that you would help us, God, to surpass even our own expectations, Lord. I pray, God, that we would put an expectation on your word and upon you, God, just like you have put an expectation upon us, God. Let us walk in faith. Let us be healed. Let us be whole. And we'll be careful to give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory, for we ask this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Whew. Praise God. Okay, so I want to extend the invitation for salvation. I pray that you were blessed today. Please share the video. Please share it, because it may be a blessing to somebody. We want to extend an invitation for salvation. If you don't know Jesus today as personal Lord and Savior, the Bible says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And that's what we're after. We're after salvation, you know, because once you give your life to God, I mean, come on, it's not apple pie in the sky. Things don't change overnight, but you do have the sufficient power to work those things out and to work your salvation out with fear and trembling. And so if you don't know him, you're welcome, Trey. God bless you, man. If you don't know him today, it's simple. People try to make salvation so difficult when it's not. This is how it works. You come to God and you say, Lord, I need you. I cannot make it without you. I realize that I cannot save myself and I need a savior. I know that I cannot enter into heaven except through your son, according to the word of God. And so I'm coming to you asking that you would come into my heart, come into my life, and that you would lead me. And when you do that, you will still have signs of imperfection. And those signs of imperfection will only remind you of how much you need God. And so the Bible says that God is faithful, and whoever calls upon him, he will save. You know, so the Bible says that if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, boom, there it is. You should be saved. You know, so with the mouth, a person confesses, but with the heart, they believe unto salvation. Okay. And so do that, and you'll be a kingdom brother and a kingdom sister. And also, if you want to be a blessing to our ministry, you can do that. And it's simple. We're not trying to press you. We're not trying to put no pressure up on anybody. We believe that anybody who supports our ministry, God sent them to do it. You know, so but we just want to make the avenues available for you. We are hoping to open up by June to start back worshiping physically. And by June, July, sometime soon, we're working on it. We have a meeting today to discuss that. But if you want to give and bless our ministry, you can do that by cash apping Inner Peace. You can text give to 423-301-5545, or you can go to our website, which is www.innerpeacechurch.org, and you can give that way. And so we appreciate you. We pray that God will add and increase to your life, and that he will bless those who cheerfully give. Let me pray us out of here. Father, we thank you for every person. We pray that you would bless them going and bless them coming, God. We pray that you would bless their efforts, their offering, that it will be used for the purpose in which it was intended. We know you do love cheerful giver. We pray for those depressed. We pray for the Murphy family. You know, in the passing of Mother Murphy, we pray that you would just strengthen Brittany, Nick, and Rachel, and the rest of the family. We pray, God, that you would just continue to touch the Wilson family. We pray that you would touch those who are incarcerated and those who are in mental institutions. We pray that you would reach them as well. As we leave this place and never your presence, we pray that the grace of God and the sweet abiding communion of the Holy Spirit would rest, rule, and abide with each of us now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen. God bless you. I am Pastor King. I look forward to seeing you all soon. I know that when God opens up the doors of our physical church, we are going to have church like we've never had it before. And starting out, we might be without a musician. And so, but we've been through enough hell to be able to make music in our own hearts. So, but if you know a musician who is looking for employment, or if you know someone and they have to have a heart of God, we're not looking to for somebody who's just trying to drain and get a check and leave. We're looking for somebody who wants to be a part of growing with us, you know. So that's what we're after, people who have a heart of God, and that's it, you know. So we're getting ready to try to put some things in place. There's a possibility that we might eventually be relocating. But we will keep everybody informed, but keep us in prayer, and we'll talk to you all soon. I am Pastor King, and I am out. If I can get out of here.